From Simon & Schuster Audio, The Art of Happiness, by His Holiness the Dalai Lama and Howard C. Cutler, M.D. Read by Howard Cutler with Ernest Abuba. Featuring His Holiness the Dalai Lama.
I think this is the first time I am meeting most of you. But to me, whether it is an old friend or a new friend, there's not much difference anyway, because I always believe we are the same. We are all human beings.
Moments before, I had found the Dalai Lama alone in an empty basketball locker room, waiting to address a crowd of 6,000 at Arizona State University. He was calmly sipping a cup of tea in perfect repose. But now he briskly rose and without hesitation left the room, emerging into the thick backstage throng of reporters, photographers, security personnel, and students. Finally, passing through a curtain, he walked on stage, bowed, folded his hands, and smiled. He was greeted with thunderous applause. At his request, the house lights were not dimmed, so he could clearly see his audience. And for several moments, he simply stood there, quietly surveying the audience with an unmistakable expression of warmth and goodwill. To those who had never seen the Dalai Lama before, his maroon and saffron monk's robes may have created an exotic impression. Yet his remarkable ability to establish rapport with his audience was quickly revealed as he sat down and began his talk.
Brothers and sisters, I am very, very happy to be here with you. And most of you, this is the first time I think a meeting. But to me, whether it's an old friend or new friend, not much differences. I always believe we are same human being. Of course, you see the different culture background and a different way of life, different, how to say, the faith or different color. But we are same. We are, I think, the human being on the combination of human body and human mind. So therefore, our physical structure also same. Our mind and also the emotional level also same. So therefore, wherever I meet some, you see, some people, I always have the feeling that we are same. I'm just meeting one another human being, which just like myself.
I have a feeling that I'm encountering another human being just like myself.
On that level,
I find it is much easier to communicate with others on that level. If we emphasize the specific characteristics, like I am Tibetan or I am Buddhist, then there are differences. But those things are secondary. If we can leave the differences aside, I think we can easily communicate, exchange ideas, and share experiences.
It was 1993. I had first met the Dalai Lama over a decade earlier while I was visiting Dharamsala, India, on a small research grant to study traditional Tibetan medicine. This beautiful and tranquil village, perched on a hillside in the foothills of the Himalayas, has been home of the Tibetan government in exile for almost 40 years. Ever since the Dalai Lama, along with 100,000 Tibetans, fled Tibet after the brutal invasion by Chinese forces. During my stay in Dharamsala, I had gotten to know several members of the Dalai Lama's family, and it was through them that my first meeting with him was arranged. Like so many other people, I came away from that first meeting in great spirits, with the impression that I had just met a truly exceptional man. As my contact with the Dalai Lama grew over the next several years, I gradually came to appreciate the many unique qualities of this man. He had a penetrating intelligence, but without artifice or cleverness, a kindness, but without excessive sentimentality, great humor, but without frivolousness, and the ability to inspire rather than awe. Over time, I became convinced that the Dalai Lama had learned how to live with a genuine sense of fulfillment and a degree of serenity that I had rarely encountered in other people, and I was determined to identify the principles that had enabled him to achieve this. I realized, of course, that many of his beliefs needed to be understood in the context of Buddhism, but I began to wonder if one could identify a set of his beliefs or practices that could be utilized by non-Buddhists as well. Practices that could be applied to our lives to simply help us become happier, stronger, perhaps less afraid. With these thoughts in mind, I hoped someday to have the opportunity to discuss his views at length and to explore his approach to everyday living. Eventually, the Dalai Lama accepted persistent invitations to come to Arizona, where in addition to his lecture at Arizona State University, he gave an intensive 5-day public workshop which was held in a desert setting near Tucson. I arranged to meet with him for long private interviews during his stay in Arizona, and these discussions later continued at his home in Dharamsala. These public talks and private conversations became the basis for much of this book. While I had looked forward to our private conversations with great anticipation, I discovered that we had some initial hurdles to overcome as we struggled to reconcile our differences in perspective. His as a Buddhist monk, mine as a Western psychiatrist. I began one of our first sessions, for instance, by posing to him certain common human problems, illustrating with several specific case histories, and asking for his explanation and advice for dealing with these problems. I was taken aback when, after a long pause and reflection, he simply shrugged his shoulders, laughed good-naturedly, and said, "I don't know." When I pressed the issue and I said it was my job as a psychotherapist to find out why people do the things they do, he laughed again and said that since an individual human mind is so complex, one may never have a full explanation of why a person does the things they do, and at any rate, it would be extremely difficult to try to figure out how the minds of 5 billion different people work. Sensing my discomfort with his response, he explained further.
In trying to determine the source of one's problems, it seems that the Western approach differs in some respects from the Buddhist approach. Underlying all Western modes of analysis is a very strong rationalistic tendency and an assumption that everything can be accounted for. But in some instances, the basic premises and parameters set up by Western science can limit one's ability to deal with certain realities. For instance, you have the constraints of various fundamental premises, such as the idea that everything can be explained within the framework of a single lifetime, and you combine these with the notion that everything can and must be explained and accounted for. But this can cause problems when you come across some phenomena which you cannot account for. Then there's a kind of tension created. It's almost a feeling of agony.
I pointed out that in Western psychology, when we come across certain behaviors that on the surface are difficult to explain, we have certain approaches we can use, such as understanding the role of the unconscious or subconscious thought processes.
In Buddhism, there is the idea of dispositions and imprints left by certain types of experiences, which is parallel to the idea of the unconscious. For instance, a certain type of event may have occurred in an earlier part of your life, which has left a very strong imprint on your mind, which can remain hidden and then later affect your behavior. I think that Buddhism can accept many of the factors that Western theorists can come up with, but on top of that, it would add additional factors. For example, it would add the conditioning and imprints from previous lives. In Western psychology, however, I think that there may be a tendency to overemphasize the role of the unconscious in looking for the source of one's problems. So when you can't explain what is causing certain behaviors or problems, the tendency is to always attribute it to the unconscious. It's a bit like you've lost something and you decide that the object is in this room. And once you have decided this, then you've already fixed your parameters. You've precluded the possibility of its being outside. So you keep on searching, but you are not finding it, yet you continue to assume that it is hidden somewhere in the room.
While recognizing these differences between Eastern and Western outlooks, it soon became clear that the Dalai Lama does not feel that one has to adopt a Buddhist perspective when examining human problems. And by the end of our series of discussions, our cultural differences no longer seemed important as we explored the problems common to all human beings. When I initially conceived of the idea for this book, exploring the Dalai Lama's views, I envisioned a conventional self-help format in which the Dalai Lama would present clear and simple solutions to all of life's problems. Then, using my background in psychiatry, I could codify his views in a set of easy instructions on how to conduct one's daily life. But as our meetings progressed, I found that his approach was much broader and more subtle than I had imagined, incorporating all the nuance, richness, and complexity life has to offer. Gradually, however, I began to hear the single note he constantly sounded. It is one of hope. His hope is based on the belief that while attaining genuine and lasting happiness is not easy, it can be done. As his message unfolded...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.